Hi everyone, I am Lucie, and welcome to this new episode of Threat Briefings. Today, I'm joined by Cyrille to talk about how attackers use a fancy red teaming tool called Brute Ratel. Hi Cyrille.
Hi Lucie.
So let's jump right in. What is Brute Ratel, Cyrille?
So Brute Ratel is a commercial adversary simulation tool. It's a post-exploitation C2 framework. It has been developed by Chetan Nayak. And it's highly resistant to detection by EDR tools. That's why he started developing this tool. He used many advanced techniques to bypass all the EDR detections mechanism that they have, like hooks, for example. You will be able to generate a custom payload. So the payload is named a badger, okay? And you can use exe format, DLL, or directly a shellcode. And you can also use different protocol to establish the C2 communication. So for example, you can do HTTP, HTTPS, DNS, SMB, and TCP traffic, but this is for the internal communication when you compromise two hosts on the network, for example. So you will start communicate between both using SMB. And you could also use DNS over HTTPS to hide your C2 infrastructure. So, and obviously the traffic is encrypted. You can modify a lot of behaviors of your badgers to evade detection. And everything is also fileless. So you can use in-memory execution, because you want to do some OPSEC, and so it's better to write everything in memory, but not on disk. Also, Brute Ratel support customizable attack profiles, so it's malleable, and you can modify the traffic to simulate, for example, AWS communication or a web API, something else.
Sounds like a very, very powerful tool. Can you tell us how threat actors are using it to remain stealthy after they gain initial access?
So, yeah, as we just said, they are using malleable profile to simulate a legit communication between the badgers and the C2 server. So that's why you can configure your listener on your C2 server to use, for example, a custom malleable profile using JSON formatted requests and responses. If you want to emulate an API, for example, you can also add some custom headers to simulate legitimate traffic. And you have also the possibility to use many host, domain, or IPs to evade detection, because obviously for the defender, it will be more complex to follow and discover the C2 infrastructure if you change and connect to different domains every time you contact your C2 server.
We know that Blockbuster, for instance, use Brute Ratel to bypass EDR. How do they do that?
Yeah, so Brute Ratel has many ways to evade EDR. So for example, you can start unhooking hooks they made on the Windows DLL. So for example, the EDR will put some hooks on NTDLL or kernel 32 DLL on Windows. So when you try to do a syscall to join a function in the Windows kernel, the EDR will intercept this communication and analyze if the call is legit or not. And Brute Ratel is able to remove this hook directly from memory. Brute Ratel is also able to encrypt memory. So as soon as the badger will go to idle, to sleep, okay, between calls to the C2 server, Brute Ratel, I mean the badger, will encrypt the memory region to hide all the call strings and so on. It's also able to use indirect syscalls to avoid EDR detection as well. So indirect syscalls is used to do syscalls to the kernel, but not using directly the NTDLL or the kernel 32 DLL. So this is another way to evade EDR. And also Brute Ratel support call stack and thread start address spoofing. This is also a way for EDR to detect bad processes. So Brute Ratel will spoof all this kind of thing to evade EDR detections.
And can Brute Ratel be used to steal credentials and move laterally through the network?
Yes. So for example, you can do Kerberos-ting. So Kerberos-ting is a Kerberos attack. You can request a service ticket and try to find the account password. So you can enumerate service principles to see if an account is configured with an SPN, Kerberos SPN. You can also steal directly authentication tokens. So tokens define your identity on a Windows computer. It's attached to the process. So if you have enough rights, you can contact a process and steal the token. And with this token, you can impersonate a user. So, and you can also impersonate privileged user if you want to move laterally, for example. So you can recreate a token, a network token this time. And with this token, you can move laterally to the network. They also have something called SC Divert. So it's a service modification feature. It could be done locally or remotely. And so imagine that you want to execute another badger on a remote machine. If you have write access to the disk, for example, you can upload a binary, the badger, on the remote target. And using an RPC call, you will say, okay, I want to modify this service and use this binary instead of the original one. And then your badger will be executed. And after that, Brute Ratel will put back the original service. So this is another way to move laterally. They also support remote command execution using SMB, PSExec, and WMI. So this is another way to do lateral movement in Windows networks.
And can it be used to avoid detection?
Yeah, so there are many ways to avoid detection. The problem with EDR is when you want to inject a process because you will start creating some threads and that's where they can detect you. And so Brute Ratel is able to inject shellcode using different techniques into legitimate processes. Like we can use notepad.exe, for example. This is an example people use a lot. They support also a reflective DLL injection. So this is a way to execute execute something inside a remote process, another process, I mean. And they can also execute C-sharp payloads. They have two techniques for that. The first one is inline. So with inline execution, you will execute C-sharp payloads directly into the badger process. And the other way is to use C-sharp reflective loading, but this time you will execute the C-sharp on another process on the machine. So this kind, it can be detected by an EDR.
Is this the only Brute Ratel feature that they use to avoid detection, or is there any other feature they can use?
Yeah, so the developer did something very smart. He implemented one-time authentication keys. They are all written into the badgers. So it has many purposes. The first one is imagine that your badgers is going to be executed by a sandbox for detection purpose. So you can say, okay, I will put only three one-time authentication keys into my badgers. So if the sandbox try to run these badgers, the next time it won't run again because all the authentication key will be used. And also for the attacker, it's also a good way to not finish with 100 or 200 clients connected to this C2 infrastructure. So this is a good way to limit this kind of issue.
So many powerful features. Does Cobalt Strike have them as well?
Yeah, today I would say that Cobalt Strike and Brute Ratel have almost the same features. This is not true for the last one we just saw, by the way. You can't use any one-time authentication keys on Cobalt Strike, but the first thing is that Cobalt Strike has been developed since 2012. So it was 10 years before Brute Ratel. And so Brute Ratel, when it was first released, was unknown to EDR, to antivirus softwares, and it was also directly designed to evade EDRs because it was already 2020, so the situation was quite different. And also, my last point is about beacon object files. So what are beacon object files? You can see them as plugins, okay, for the C2. So when you want to extend the features of your badgers or your Cobalt Strike beacon, you can use both. So you will load both into your beacon or badgers. And so this is very powerful, but unfortunately, they are not compatible between Cobalt Strike and Brute Ratel. So you have to modify them and to be able to use them on Brute Ratel today.
Thank you very much, Cyrille.
Thank you, Lucie.
So now let's talk a bit about how Vectra AI can detect attackers, even if they use Brute Ratel or Cobalt Strike to remain stealthy and do other things. As you can see here, Vectra AI detects attackers across the kill chain, aligning closely with most of the MITRE attack framework techniques. Initially, Vectra detects privilege anomalies, such as unauthorized escalations or misuse of admin credentials, and flags early compromise attempts. As attacks progress, Vectra identifies suspicious operations within Active Directory and administrative actions. The platform proactively alerts on suspicious remote execution attempts, indicative of lateral movement. It also uncovers hidden command and control tunnels attackers rely on for covert communication. It also spots automated replication behavior, signaling rapid internal malware spread. Unauthorized external remote access activities are quickly identified, limiting attacker persistence. And ultimately, Vectra AI detects attack exfiltrations attempts and ransomware activities. So as you can see, with our platform covering network, cloud, and identity, even the stealthiest attackers cannot remain hidden. So that's it for this episode of Threat Briefing. Thank you so much again, Cyrille, for explaining everything about Brute Ratel here.
Thank you for having me today.
Want to learn more about the Blockbuster ransomware payload itself? Don't forget to subscribe to the show, as we're going to tell you everything you need to know about it based entirely on their internal communications. See ya!